can just tell us, for the benefit of our audience today, who is Silas Nyanchwani?
Okay, Silas is like I'm a Kenyan writer. Previously, I've worked as a journalist, and I'm still a journalist, though now I've switched into creative writing, and I've just published my first novel, Sexorcised. That is, I think, currently the trending book in the country.
Well, this is a very intriguing title, Sexorcised, and I'm just curious, and I can bet so many Kenyans are curious what this Sexorcised is about. It sounds really intriguing. What is the book about?
The book is basically about divorce, and it's about the experience of one man who just discovers a very bad secret about his marriage, and then now he has to divorce his wife. So the book now basically tries to capture the kind of like emotional turbulence that men undergo when they break up, especially when you have this marriage that you invested so much. So the book is basically about divorce.
This protagonist, the main character, Bruce Moma, you know, for many readers, sometimes they're not able to differentiate between the author and the character. Could Bruce Momani be you, Silas Nyanchwani?
No, absolutely not, because we could be more different. Bruce is like, he's a rich guy, I'm not very rich, he's 41, I'm like 34, you know, like we're so different. He's more outgoing, a bit more reserved, you know, he's so much into casual sex, and I don't think whether I'm that man, like he's the exact opposite of who I am. Mm-hmm. So the book is purely fiction.
Oh, purely fiction.
Yeah.
Ah, great. And your book has prominently tackled a lot of issues, like you just mentioned, issues of love, dating, depression, the turbulence of marriage and stuff. And so let me take you to dating. What do you make of online dating? In Kenya today?
Yeah, so I think online dating has really caught up in Kenya. Because I remember about like 20 years ago, what we had basically people had to go to the newspaper to advertise themselves like they're single. And I remember like the Saturday Nation, they used to have like a section where people could advertise themselves. But, you know, then came Facebook, came Twitter, we even have Tinder. So online dating is currently very popular. Especially Tinder, that's not even among my friends. They get their dates from Tinder lately. Among my peers, millennials, I think it's the in thing. The only thing I've heard is, I haven't tried it, but I've heard like in Nairobi, for instance, commercial sex workers have also moved to Tinder. And it's an interesting space, because sometimes finding genuine love is not very easy, and I'm open to such kind of ideas. Wherever you can find love or death, I'm cool with it.
Okay, yeah. And of course that comes with some level of risk taking.
Yeah.
And of course it matters hard, there's a lot of risk involved. So for someone looking for love online, what are some red flags or some risk someone can intuitively avoid?
Yeah, so I think online the thing is that you can pretend to do you or not. Like a seller can create a profile and just be anything they want to be. And unless you really know how to, like you have some good sense of discernment, so that when you meet physically for the first time, you're able to pick these red flags. It can be tricky, because some people, like psychopaths, they really know how to hide their bad traits. But the thing with what I know about online dating, most of the time people go there, they're not really looking for something that is long or sustainable. I think people just want some casual fling like that. And I'm not very sure but I doubt if there's someone who really goes into Tinder or Facebook or Twitter to look for someone that they can date. I do know a few people who have their marriages started from Facebook, but they're still going on strong. But that's more like of an exception than the rule.
Okay.
Yeah, but it's where we are, because we live in the digital age. Everyone has a phone, a smartphone, and eventually we'll go there. It's really big in the Western world. In Kenya, it's really, it's also growing. Yeah, but in terms of red flags, for example, for men in Nairobi, what I've heard is that if you get a date from Tinder, chances are that she could be a thief. She could be a thief. This is for men. I don't know much for women. So some of the data they go through.
Yeah.
But we even wrote it in one of the blogs that we ran, Ruby Cool, about how you meet someone and then she's back upfront about payment, and then they come to your place and then they spike your food or you, and then they steal from you. So you really have to be very cautious because it's a stranger, you don't know them. So you have to do a lot of background checks and at least get to know who they are before you can even move to the next stage. I don't think whether it's something that is new. Traditionally, older men always went for younger women. There are some biological, sociological, and evolutionary reasons for that. And there's a word that people nowadays throw around on social media called hypergamy. Hypergamy is like women who always date men who are on the higher ground.
Okay.
There are men who have like materially well off, you know. And there are reasons for that. That means that for a man, you can only become stable when you're older. You know, when you're young, most likely you're broke.
Mm-hmm.
And then, when a man is young, he's broke, but he has a lot of promise. And then for a woman, when you're young, you know.
So promises are not sustainable in a relationship. So
most young women, especially in an environment like Nairobi, let's face it, Nairobi is really very expensive for everyone. Women, like, there's something that we trade off with women. So for an older person, obviously it's very easy to sponsor a young woman in exchange with, you know, you want to maybe kind of your youth, you know, bolster your ego, because an older woman might not really tolerate an older man. So that's all.
So like in your book, The Sexorcised, this character Bruce, he picks women whom he then dumps, and he has a trail of them, what I would say,
like flings along the way.
Flings along the way.
Mm-hmm.
Why have you brought out your character like that? A character who leaves a trail of broken hearts. Is it something, what would you say about that?
No one
are using maybe women and
When I was doing the research for the novel and I was talking to divorced men, I realized once you've separated or you've divorced from your wife, the constant advice people will be giving you is like, just sleep around, you know, just sleep around, have fun, now you're free, you know.
Okay.
And now that sort of became the theme, like if you spoke like, I don't know, 6 or even 7 out of 10 men, the constant advice will be, sleep around. I'm sure even women when they're divorced, I think that's what
both sides of the
relationship. Yeah, even women, I think when if a woman has gone through divorce or separation or after a breakup from a long relationship, most people generally, the advice you get from people is like, just sleep around or find out that you can heal.
So,
and sleeping around
is going to do it. Is that what you call sexorcised? Is that where the title is derived?
Now, the title comes from you know, in Africa, we have this thing that we believe in demons so much. And people go to church, you know, we pray for, people visit wagangas and all that.
Yeah.
So the title generally is a combination of the word sex and exorcism, you know. So that, like, when you're going through some pain, people will advise you to use different ways. Some will tell you that go to church, some will take to drugs, and some will take to alcohol, you know. And then some will tell you that maybe you can get a woman or get a man and just try to get over it. And so it's a way that people can use sex to overcome the kind, any kind of demon that they have in them.
Mental issues of the characters. And how would you generally, is your view on tackling mental challenges, mental health challenges?
You know, the thing with fiction is that fiction does not really offer answers. We just portray things as they are. And I remember like the last 2 years we've had some big problems with the femicide, you know, women have been killed. And some of the reasons that they've been killed is because of what I highlighted there. Like men, especially men in the military or the disciplined forces, they do have a lot of mental, unaddressed mental problems.
Yeah.
And so the book maybe can raise that discussion, like on how should you go about it. Maybe you are married to, so there are all these red flags, like initial indication from the beginning, like there's some, this man is violent, like it's indicated. So
yeah,
if you are living with a violent spouse, like what options do you have?
Okay.
Because generally, that someone does not wake up on and just kills you, there are all these red flags to follow. So maybe the book can raise the discussion on if you are living with an abusive person, violent person, what kind of options do you have?